watching paint dry.
No, just kidding. Johnny Magic here at Hline Conversions, clean features, or not clean features, for actually Hline Conversions and e-charger systems. That's where we're at today. Back on the H2 Hummer, Duramax swap, redline package, just dying to drive this thing. I mean, I'm talking about all the power. But today we want to talk about the things that we didn't talk about in the step four. And at this point in time, you should have your cooling pack and all that stuff in there. You should have your transmission cooler that mounts to the upper tie bar and lower tie bar. You should have your dash 10 stainless beta lines back to the transmission. You should have your radiator and intercooler pipes on and all that kind of stuff. Should have your new pressure tank that comes in the kit. It looks like something like this. It is different, even though it looks identical to the one that come out of here. It has a plug on the bottom of it. It's a low coolant sensor, and if you can run the H2 one, but you're going to see this light in there saying low coolant. So with this tank that resolves that light, we supply that through Hline Conversions website, or hummerconversionkit.com supplies that. On this one here, we've been doing something different on the intake system. For years, we've done all kinds of intakes, and I've been seeing a lot of intake systems out there to where it has an open air filter and hood. And, you know, that's fine, I guess, for a race car going down the quarter mile, but not no Hummer that goes down the highway, because this Duramax, with the size of this fan and the seals on the hood and everything, creates a static pressure underneath the hood, so everything becomes heat soaked. So if you have an open air filter, like I've seen conversions out there and stuff, you're just pulling that hot air back into the engine. And even though it's turbocharged, it's tougher for it to make the kind of power that you want. Plus, you create what we call almost a thermal runaway. You know, the hotter the air is going in the motor, the hotter the motor gets, which in turn makes more heat underneath the hood, which is sucking in. So it's a thermal effect. And all of a sudden, you got a whole overheating issue and no power, loss of performance, and of course, fuel efficiencies in the toilet. So the intake system, believe it or not, that we have been messing with is actually a modified version of the H2. So it fits exactly where the H2 box used to sit. It pulls cold air from the outside like the H2 used to do, but the magic's on the inside and the diameter of the piping, stuff like that, location of the airflow meter, you know, things that you won't have to worry about if you buy the intake system that we supply, again, through Hline or HummerConversionKit.com. So that's the intake side. Here's your cooling side. You got everything on there. Of course, we took the hood back off just so everybody can see what's going on. Bumper's still off. There is a modification you have to do to the bumper. You'll notice that, you know, we could have turned this tranny cooler this way and had lines running that way, but I like it because it's straight up and down, and it'll allow flow back a lot better. So with the lines down, they do get in the way of the plastic bumper, or the plastic part on the bumper. Essentially, you just take this hole saw, like a 1-inch hole saw, mark those areas, slide the bumper on there, mark where these are hitting that area, and just clip that part of the bumper. It's real simple to do. You just drill in the hole saw. If you don't want to do it, you can probably re-engineer this a little bit, or put, you know, 1010 union 90s on here, kick them over, whatever you want to do. But it, to me, when it's all said and done, it's got stainless lines hanging down, it looks pretty cool to me. So that's why I always like it. But the biggest thing that most people ask, and this is a tough one, you know, and it's the wiring, you know. The wiring to the Duramax, to the H2, there's no book out there that tells you how to do that. You know, it took a little bit to figure that out in the early days when we first done our first 03. But the luxury of it is all GM. 90% of the parts associated with the conversion come from GM in some form or some way. Maybe some modification, like, for example, to this harness. I mean, this right here I'm holding is called the C2 connector. It does plug right into the factory fuse center, but that doesn't mean the wire is in the right position. So what we do is we offer an in-house service where you just send your harness, which is the harness that plugs into the fuse center. It's also the same harness that plugs into the computers. You just pop that off, send that to us. We'll do all the wiring changes and the modifications there and stuff like that. We'll also supply you a download to remove security, increase performance, be able to adjust tire size. If you have a DTC down the road, a trouble code or whatever, pops up, you can diagnose everything with this one simple program. And of course, it gives you 500 horse, 800 foot-pounds of torque, which is, to me, the best part of it. But so send the harness to us, we'll do it for you. If you want to try to do it, we'll be happy to send you about 5 pages of schematics, and good luck. So I can't even remember how to do it. But anyways, you basically, after you get the harness back, you plug it back into the fuse center, just like the harness that you had unplugged from the fuse center. So everything's color-coded. Here you got green tape, so you're going to go over and find the green connector for it. You got the one with the purple, it's going to go purple, so on. Actually, I believe, there is one connector when you get all said and done. The two won't plug together. And one being, let me see if I can get this off of here. This is the Duramax connector. This will be the one that you're like, where does it plug into, or how? It doesn't plug into anything. Well, it's supposed to match this one right here. Now, this one is actually coming from the Duramax. If I remember this right. This is the input. Yeah, this purple wire, and there's a black wire here on that connector. Those two wires, the purple and black, are important for your fuel sender, okay? That's what that's the input to the Duramax ECU that it needs to see the fuel sender, so you know what fuel level it is. And then over here on the blue connector, you're going to see the purple wire, and you can see the black wire there. They're different size diameter. Don't worry about it. You can go ahead and connect those. If you want to do it real pretty and stuff like that, you can just get a 2-pin connector, male, female. If you don't really care about that, you'll never be back here, hopefully, ever. You can just use, you can solder them together, heat shrink, you can connect them, you can bubble gum, it doesn't matter. Make those connections black to black, purple to purple, and then the wire left, or the couple wires left, or whatever, just disregard it. If you want to cancel it, make it all pretty, you can cancel it, tape it all in the harness, or you can just leave the connector and stick it underneath the fuse center, however that you want to do that, but you want to connect those two. The next thing you're going to see on this blue connector is a wire that, well, a lot of times I don't even use it. This wire here is part of the ABS system. ABS is great for those that, I guess, don't know how to drive a Hummer, or those that are crazy and think they can drive a Hummer. But I can tell you that with this wire hooked up and 800, well, this one's 800 horsepower motor, it's going to try to fight this engine. So, for example, as soon as this motor, it's 30 miles an hour, you get it, lay into this Hummer, it's going to try to break the tires loose, and the brakes are going to try to go traction active. Unless you set a traction active override or ABS override, you have an issue with that. You'll probably end up just pulling the fuse, ABS fuse, or you don't connect this up. If you want the traction control and everything, and you're not going to try to peel out all the time, good luck with that. But if you're conservative and everything, then you just take this pink wire, and you're actually going to hook this to switched ignition. And the best way to hook this to switched ignition is without trying to graft and tie into other wires, and it's complicated. But just come up to the fuse center here and just take a voltmeter, or we could tell you which one it is. There's a lot of circuits here that go hot when you turn the key on. And now they sell these little jumpers that you take a fuse out, you plug the jumper into that, and you put the a fuse, so it's still fused. You're just using that as a donor circuit to activate this, and then you can tie that in to your system. Let's see, the next thing. This is a, well, hopefully you have the right motor. This is the LBZ, well, this is the LBZ VIN D. This is actually the LLY. We chose this because we can just make more power out of these things. I mean, they've been around, they're pre-emissions, they're a bulletproof, can make great power type of drivetrains. But it has a throttle pedal jump harness, and this you got to get inside the cab, straight to the throttle pedal. Back in the old day, actually, I won't even talk about that, because there's more circuits to the Duramax throttle pedal than there is for the H2 Hummer. So in the kit, we supply this jump harness, we supply that throttle pedal so that you have the proper circuits. If you don't have the proper circuits, you'll find out that it doesn't operate properly. It won't downshift properly, or it won't downshift properly. Cruise control won't, all kinds of little things don't work. And you know, drive you crazy. But, you know, we'll supply that harness for you. You plug it into the throttle pedal, and then, of course, the other end is out here underneath the hood somewhere, buried in the world of wires. Right here is the longest connector on the bunch of connectors. That's the one that's going to plug right into your jump harness. And then the other end of this jump harness is going to run inside the firewall. There is a hole. If you pull back the insulation right of the main harness going into the body, there's a plug there. You can pull that plug out. You might modify that hole a little bit, or you can pull the pins out of the end of the connector, as long as you remember which wire goes in what hole or whatever. Stick it through there, you know, type of deal, and plug it into the throttle pedal. But that takes care of your throttle. That takes care of your power and ground. We talked about that. And one part that we will talk about, since we're right here talking about stuff, is you have what we call the frame harness. When you took the body off, you had to remove underneath this fuse center wires that look like this. You have a big red connector, you know, another little connector, and it had wires that were plugged in and that were color-coded to different things, you know. And of course, we talked about the blue one. Here's the purple one. It goes back to the other purple. But this one here, with the blue tape on it. Now, this has come from your transfer case, okay? So you're going to end up doing some modifications to, let's see, it's been a while, but I think that normally I take in, yeah, see, this is the other end of it. This is actually going back into the vehicle. This is coming from the frame. It's attached to the frame. These two, of course, are going to plug together. But the transfer case that we're using doesn't have the same style of wiring. And up here, you know, you will end up taking and clipping a few wires, and I will tell you where those go in order to make the transfer case part of it work. But while we're underneath the hood, I just wanted to show you, so when we start talking about the four-wheel drive stuff, you'll know, because by then you'll probably have all this plugged in. You might even have this plugged into that, but I'm going to say, hey, look for the black connector with the blue tape. And, you know, on the frame side, this would be the frame side of it, because it's running back down along the frame. This would be the body side of it. I'm going to tell you either the frame or the body side to clip a wire, and I'll just tell you what wire color, and I'll say, you know what, clip this back. You know, I'm just going to give you an example. Clip the wire on the blue taped connector. Clip it on the frame side. Clip the yellow and black. Run that to ground. You know, I'm going to tell you different things like that. So, you know, that'll make it really simple, so you don't have to try to figure out how to do your four-wheel drive, because there is a lot of little bitty small tricks in making that four-wheel drive system work properly, or work at all, actually. But we'll talk about that in another episode. So, again, at this time, plug in your new harness, get all your connectors plugged in, make your modification to the blue connector, go into the, wherever it went, the white connector. Look around here, this little dude, the black, the purple, pink wire for ABS to switch ignition. That's it. That's all you need on the wiring side of it. You're golden, okay? There, as far as the fuse center. Now, you'll have a glow plug control module, which is located back beside the turbo on the engine. And, you know, if you're lucky, you got the wire that plugs into it, so like a big battery cable, like a 1-aught, one gauge or whatever cable coming off of it, and you'll route that up to here. And we supply this. This is a large fuse. This you know, fuses that. I think it's like a 125 amp fuse that goes back to this, which is, you know, battery basically, is what that becomes. But that you'll connect that glow plug wire to this. If you got a newer motor and stuff, you'll probably have like a well, let's just say if you had the LBZ motor, you'll probably have another cable, you know, that's not going to, it's going to the inlet air heater. Now that you could take and run into an additional fuse, which we offer that as well. It's a two-blade fuse holder, or you can, you know, if you're just coming up with your own stuff. It's about 125 amp fuse that you'll need for that as well. And let's see, everything else on the wiring, I think that's pretty much done on the wiring side as far as the fuse center, the power and the ground. You know, you have your computers, you plug your computer back in, your TCM or transmission control module, if it's the newer like LBZ, it actually fastens here on the shroud. Now, if it's an older version like this, we actually make a bracket that sets off of here to where the bigger TCM will set right up here in place. Intake side, of course, you already have your airflow meter plugged in. You know, you should be on the electrical side to actually get the vehicle up and running, starting and stuff. You've got all your connections made. If it is an LBZ, though, like an 07 LBZ, you will have a couple extra wires that you have to pull down to the what we call the diagnostic link connector or DLC ports, and those will come off of this. And of course, again, if you send the harness to us, we're going to modify it, but you're going to see two wires that go through this connector, because at the other end where this plugs into the actual H2 Hummer, it doesn't have those wires as well. So these wires will come off separately, and you can just run those down along with the throttle pedal, jump harness, down into inside the vehicle, and those wires will be marked. They'll say like pin 7 and pin 14. You know, all those are the can high, can low circuits. You know, circuit number 2500, 2501. You're going to run those inside, and we'll already have a pin on it for you, and we'll just tell you what hole to plug that into the DLC port. So when you go to program the vehicle, what happens is, you know, when you plug the programmer in, you got full can, it'll communicate back to the, you know, to the ECU and do your programming stuff like that for you. So if you don't plug those in, it won't program on the LBZ. The older motors like this, they don't have can, they just run on serial bus, and that's already established in this connector, so you won't have to worry about it. Even like the VIN 1, which is the LB7, you know, those are all, you know, low speed communication, so you don't have to worry about that. But at this point, you should have all that done, battery in it. Then at this time, you would, you know, of course, make sure you have fluids and everything, and you know, all that's good. But transmission fluid, transfer case fluid, you know, engine fluid, you know, filters, stuff like that. You got coolant in the system and everything. You're kind of ready to start the vehicle up. Before you start it, of course, you want to go over and make sure that you have fuel to the engine. And this one, yep, here it is, it's missing this little cap, but pull this intake system out of here, make it a little bit easier so you can see what's going on here. Okay, so this is like a big Schrader valve. You can push in the center of that like you can a tire, you know, valve stem on a car or whatever, and it'll allow fluid to come out. So what you're going to do, there's a couple of things. First off is make sure you have diesel in your tank, okay? And then you're going to turn around and you have this new filter on there. Well, you couldn't prime that filter before putting it on there. Well, I guess you can. You could pre-prime as much fuel as you can get into it and then go ahead and put it on there. But on top of the filter, there's a big button. It's called a primer bulb. You're going to pump that up, and there's a bleeder right beside that primer bulb, little 10 millimeter plastic set screw. You can just loosen that and it'll start shooting out foam, it'll shoot out fuel, and when it starts running a steady stream of fuel, at that point in time, go ahead and just tighten the little plastic valve, tighten that up, and then start pumping on this again, then come up to the Schrader valve and do the same thing and get clear fluid up there, because what happens now that you've got it all primed, this thing's going to light up for you really quick. You know, you won't be cranking on it forever, burning up starters and stuff like that if you get it primed. So now that you got the system primed, now you're going to go in the vehicle, and the first thing you're going to do is you're going to get out your download, your programmer, and you're going to plug that into the DLC port, and then it'll ask you to turn the key to on. It'll take you through a programming sequence. It basically tells you everything that you need to do, but I'm going to tell you what you should do, and you know, as far as settings and stuff, what works the best for us that we found out. You know, it's going to ask you a performance level. Set it on level 3, okay, to start with. Level 3 is all that you need, really, in the H2 Hummer. It won't slip the transmission or put anything in limp mode or none of that craziness. But, you know, in a normal application, you'd set it on level 3, It's going to ask you for your tire size, you know, measure your tires, see what size that is. That's going to calibrate the speedometer, okay? It's going to ask you what gear ratio you have. Just put in 410 is going to be fine for that. It's also going to ask you remove security. This is the big one. If you don't remove the security, what will happen is you'll go to start this and it won't start. It might start and die. You know, it'll throw a fast security light and stuff like that. So go ahead and remove the security. It'll save you a headache. There is other procedures to be able to bypass the security, since it does have a BMS on board on the H2 Hummer. You can do a slow learn procedure, or if you have a Tech 2, you can do it like that, or EF wired or whatever. You know, there's tons of other ways, but you buy the programmer, you're done, you got the power, plus you have a tool that you can use and diagnose any problems that you have, whether they're static DTCs or actually while it's running. You can sit there and look at your injector balances, you can look at actual fuel pressure versus desired fuel pressure, all kinds of things, airflow meter, you know, how much is flowing and all that kind of stuff that hopefully you don't have to mess with. But if you ever did get in a jam and need to know what's going on, you'd have the tool associated with being able to do it, instead of having a, you know, some high tech stuff that you don't really need. So anyways, program it, follow follow what it says to do. It's going to tell you, you know, congratulations, turn the key off, the power is now increased. At that point in time, you should be able to go in there and just turn the key to crank, and it should start up. You know, if it doesn't start up the first try or whatever, don't freak out. Come back out here, pump on this till it gets hard, go back in there and hit it again. It should fire up for you. And of course, as soon as it fires up, go straight to the transmission dipstick and start pumping fluid in there. You know, what I always like to do is, you know, I put like, you know, whatever the recommended quarts, I think it's 7 or 8 quarts or whatever, into the transmission. You know, if it's used, you know, you just drained it, you know, put that much back in there, and then turn around and, you know, get the vehicle started, pull it down into drive, then put it back into park, then come check it. Check both sides of the dipstick too, because there's always one side that's going to read higher than the other. Go to the lowest reading on there and just keep adding, and every time that you add a quart or two or whatever, go in there, throw it back into gear, you know, put it back into park, and then come back up and check it. Get it to its cold level, you know, same with the power steering fluid, get the power steering fluid up, you know, because as soon as you start it up, it's going to suck it down, and, you know, you need to go back and add that, and, you know, you should be good to go. I think that probably this is going to cover pretty much everything that you're going to need to know to get it up and running and stuff like that, and hopefully we just have one more step, which will be talking about doing the four-wheel drive and some of the other pre-check things before you drive that I like to do, and, you know, just safety precautions, you know, because at this time everybody they're the most excited. It's like, oh God, I heard it run, you know, and I want to go drive it, but, you know, let's just stop there and go back and recheck everything. You know, make sure you don't chew up a hose or spit off a belt or, you know, who knows what'll happen, but I've probably seen it all, anyways, it pays to recheck everything that you've done before you get excited about hitting the road. Johnny Magic? Yep, Johnny Magic. Hline Conversions, eCharger Systems, HummerConversionKit.com. We'll see you.